Ahmed Abou El Ela. Ahlan wa sahlan. Honestly, it's great to have you with us today. The insurance expert. You've embarked on a lot of changes in the past few years. So first of all, how are you? Very nice to have you here.
It's great to be here. Yani, part of this, I mean, guys, you are miles ahead and you're doing great. It's a pleasure, yani, to be finally sitting here after so many great people have been sitting here and to keep up with them. That's, it's great. And it's an honor to be here with you guys.
Yeah, so insurance expert, so I think this is what you've been doing ever since you graduated.
Exactly.
Undergrad. Okay.
Exactly. This has been my first job as a door-to-door salesman selling medical insurance. Been doing it for the next like 13 years. In the middle, went to account management instead of sales, which is a different kind of sales, but still remain in the, you know, the commercial part of the insurance servicing side. Yeah. And then latest is, you know, I moved in to the UAE in Abu Dhabi, but on the insurance side. So before that, I was on a broker side. So the difference is, you know, the broker is the consultant for the client that gets them multiple insurance companies to work with. But now I'm on the insurance side.
And how big do you change. Find, like, this change was
big change.
Big change.
Big okay. Change. Big change. Yeah. Insurance companies are huge machines with lots of many details. And it's a very dynamic machine. And I'm in the medical insurance industry, so it's quite... it requires a lot of maintenance. That's how we call it in the insurance side. Other than the general insurance, the medical side is always on the maintenance. You're dealing with two very sensitive things to any human being, their health and their money.
Yes.
So
not just that, their health, their money, and that potential, you know, futuristic look as well.
Exactly.
It's different from person to person. Some people are, I would say, superstitious. Some people are more conservative.
It depends. It depends from, I mean, from one person to another. But by the end of the day, if it's a need that you need to fulfill, inshallah, no one ever uses the insurance, but it's a must that you have, you know, to avoid any future such sudden situations where you can be put in and... you need to have this access to the medical service. Provider. You need to have the liquidity. Sometimes you can't have both immediately. So it's not just, you know, the safety of mind from getting exposed to a major risk in actually spending or paying the expenses of your medical treatment, but also the accessibility. I need to be, admitted inpatient now. So... this is part of the medical insurance services, is to grant you this kind of access immediately.
I can see some of the ways in which that message would probably have resonated with your clients when you were on the sales side. But Ahmed, tell us a little bit about, because I know when you were doing your executive MBA journey, you were traveling between Egypt and the UAE. And I know from some of my colleagues that travel, I mean, that just adds another layer of things that you have to deal with and factor in while you're trying to carve out time to study. So tell us a little bit about what you were facing when you were coming into the program.
It's time management. If you recall our previous dean, Professor Selina, I remember quite well, I was asking her, how do you manage to do your deanery as a job as a dean, as a marketing executive, and as a consultant in these companies, and also as a coach? How do you manage such all of these tasks? And also, you have your own family. So she told me this notion, policing your time. It's not easy. At all. It may sound very simple and very easy, But in reality, to manage your tasks between your job, my team, my clients, the pre-reading that you need to do while I'm back in the country, coming here, the time change, which, believe it or not, was making a difference. These couple of hours difference in timings was, in sleeping, and it was making an impact one way or another. And, but of course, it wouldn't have been easy if it wasn't for the support of my colleagues back at my old company, and my colleagues, of course. So I think it was two main things: is how you police your time and your tasks, and the support. It's not just entirely me, for sure.
No, go for it. Too hard.
Because I wanted to ask, and do you think this, how you approach this, was different from how you used to be before? You know, so was it something drastic that you had to do or learn, or had you already been doing this to some extent before you went into the program?
No, you have to. It was a change in mindset. You have to manage this. If you're unable to manage it, eventually it will, it will backfire, whether at your job or in the MBA. And unfortunately, a couple of times it overlapped because of mismanagement. I'm unable to fulfill my duties with my team, or at a certain time I'm unable to be as responsive and supportive to my team and my clients back at my job. So it's the change in the mindset that you have to do this to be able to complete this program and really primarily to complete this program and to really benefit from it. This is not just, do the assignments and pass the, no, of course, you have to be present at the moment to benefit from each and every moment, whether it's group work or in class or in the discussions and so on.
It's getting that value, that ROI, as we say, from your investment.
Bilal's quote, of course.
Yes, exactly.
Of course.
But I think that after some time, I mean, it is a pretty long program. It's a habit change. Don't you start enjoying it? Doesn't become much of a burden? I mean, these small breaks, I don't know. You tell me, these small breaks coming in and out, you start to really synchronize and it becomes a harmony in your life, kind of.
Exactly. And maybe it's hard in the beginning, but again, everything is hard in the beginning. But once you practice it, and I bet the first couple of episodes you were here, it wasn't that easy. But now it's easy for you, but not easy for me.
I think this speaks to our to the future of business. Things are a lot of remote working is now becoming very popular, and people actually not recently, a while ago, years ago, the idea, the concept of traveling around has become sort of acceptable or accepted within any job description to an extent. So I think the future does change our perception of how we work and how we adapt to the workplace in every form.
It's adapting. I think this is the key word here. It's adapting and actually embracing it. Again, everything that is new in the beginning, just embrace that the errors, the mistakes, how hard it will be in the beginning. I mean, the beginning for me here was pretty hard. The beginning of the program was pretty hard. But then by time, one step at a time, I like to call it one bump, speed bump, one at a time. And then it becomes khalas. You pass it, everything passes. But you just have to embrace it and not just let it go and give up from the early, even with the mistakes and errors and the heat in the beginning. I think it will pass eventually.
Because eventually, with all of that bumps, مطبات. You're supposed to focus on the knowledge and focus on the information, the the skills and the acquiring of
So even I think people, I mean, even after the COVID and everything changed, I bet you people weren't comfortable meeting on Teams and meeting online and not seeing each other. But I think now sometimes, like, I want to come and meet you or my client. Oh, no, I'll just keep it on Teams then. You need to drive and come and go. So I think you can apply this on changes, the ones that you're facing now. You're talking about traveling and working remotely. Adapting, I think, is the key word. Eventually, you have to adapt.
And what do you think, if you think back on your 2 years of studies? So what was easy and that surprised you, that it was that easy? And what is sort of like memorable or enjoyable that surprised you that you weren't expecting?
What was easy? I think getting to know the cohorts and getting to know the people. You know, Hult is very diverse. You have people from all over. Even I remember people flying in from their home countries, different industries, different backgrounds. People are different. So, but actually, it was very, very easy to get to know them and get to work with them. So I think that was unexpectedly very, very cool.
Okay.
And I think that was very special about our cohort as well. How easy we developed the relationship together. Mm. And I think it gave an idea that diversity is okay, can also build such relationship. What was hard? Actually, I think coping and time managing. Mm. That was really hard, managing your time, the family, friends, work, and your team members here. So that was a bit hard. Yeah.
If you could look back in retrospect, what would you do differently with regards to that journey?
What would I do differently? I try not to think of it that way. It's done.
It's done.
But I would say if I'm going to a program again, I would be more engaging, even more engaging, and try to even benefit from it as much as I can. Although I try to do, but this is what I would repeat. Sorry, if I go back and repeat this program, this is what would do a bit different is engage more.
So yeah. how did the program sort of like push you out of your comfort zone?
I think it was the change in mindset and changing in the perspective from on how business is run, believe it or not, it's not just about the program as in the syllabus. You get to benefit to when you hear the perspective of your cohort, of your colleagues in discussions, like in real life cases and situations. So accepting that and actually trying to apply that back into the real world and where I'm working, this was the major change, I would say.
Mm-hmm.
Did you feel like it was, as Andy said, incremental with every course? There was something that you could have implemented back, or did you have a major impact towards the end, let's say, like with the shift? I think it was a gradual shift.
Graduate, what do you mean?
Graduate? Like a gradual shift with each course, yeah.
Yes, there's always this, I remember with Ali Fenwick's course in the second course, first course actually, he always come up with, you have to, there has to be, what's this called? A key takeaway. Mm. Key takeaway. It doesn't have to be something that is huge and dramatic, but it could be something as simple as like one course, some things that are very complex that you try to simplify, that does not, it's complex in its place, and vice versa. Some things are just very simple, but you tend to make it very complex that eventually it doesn't work. Yusuf Akbar's quote. Key take. Each and every course I have, I note them down. This is the key takeaway from this course. Or one or two key takeaways from this course. I think this was the development throughout the journey. That was the development and taking these key takeaways and try to apply them in the real life.
It reprograms the way you think. Going into this, you really reprogram your approach completely from day one. I'm talking about my experience from day one, from that very first course. You really have to start looking at things differently. And therefore, with every program, course, assignment, team group presentation, you're rewiring your synapses. You know, it's just, it's fascinating. I understand where you're coming from. Yeah.
Yeah, again, it's for me, it was more on the change in perspective, how you see things. Again, you could actually benefit from things that's not necessarily about the syllabus or the project. It could be an inspiration from one of your colleagues. It could be an advice from one of your professors that could alter your development throughout the journey. So this has been, I mean, it doesn't have to be, you know, the core, the program that you have to be. You can benefit at your own pace. You can benefit at your own way. So yeah, that for me was the change in perspective throughout the journey.
And what do you miss about it? Because, you know, one of the recurring themes is that
nostalgia.
Yeah, you know, there is so much nostalgia. And I think even my cohorts, as we are rapidly getting to the end of our journey, I know a lot of us are already starting to feel nostalgic. So what do you miss?
I think what...
Watch out.
Every, I mean, no, to be honest, it's the times that we have together. The stressful times, the good times, and again, stressful times.
The best of times, it was the worst of times.
I mean, yeah. We were together in the same, in many courses, of course, and the future mindset challenge. I would do that over and over again. Although it was one of the most stressful any periods anyone could be in, but I would do it over and over again. Actually, this has always been the times that really impacts you. For me, it was the teamwork. This is what I remember, actually, sitting in these glass rooms and discussing and arguing and sharing.
And churning. Yeah. Churning the
and
machine.
Heating,
stirring the pot, yes.
And arguing, and then yes. Go out and and that was the most part I miss, big time.
Yeah,
and the traveling, of course.
But I mean, you know, it wasn't that long after you graduated that you actually moved over to the UAE permanently.
Yeah,
you know,
that must have been a big change. You feel like this program or this step had an impact towards that?
Big time. Coming over to Dubai that frequent, you know, being exposed to expertise here, I think it gave me the confidence to they helped me how to approach here and make the move here, and yeah, it helped a lot. It helped big time to make this move easier, I would say. And at least I have my friends here already that helped me a lot with this move, big time.
So how are you still policing your time now that you are post-program? Because you suddenly have more time available. So are you still policing your time? And if you are, how are you filling your time now?
Habit formation.
I have a 9 months
more family. Mashallah, so congratulations.
Yeah, that could fill up all the time in the world.
Yes. That's the best way to spend your time.
Yes.
One of the things, I believe it or not, I really used to miss is the pre-readings that we used to do in the course before coming in. I think this is something that needs to keep on going. Keep reading anything, you know, articles, books, podcasts, and so on and so forth. This is what I would start doing again, actually. Filling my time. But policing my time, I think it needs more policing now.
Yeah. You shifted gears.
A lot more thieves, a lot more time thieves suddenly. Speaking of shifts, do you feel like throughout, you know, the coursework, I'm bringing it back because it just hit me that, did you feel like there was any new interest sparked other than, let's say, the insurance industry, something that you discovered, I like this, I didn't know I enjoy this?
I'm still in the journey of finding out, to be honest. Yes, it sparked big time. But nothing that I would say that can materialize, maybe. But I think I'm in the process of just finding out something that I'm more on the passionate side. That doesn't mean I'm not passionate about what I'm doing. No, but more on the at some place where I can, I would say, add more value. But believe it or not, our future mindset project has always been on my mind. It's what one way or another related to the health insurance, and one way is getting, you know, these AI and big data into making a change in that aspect. But actually looking at it from more on the practical side, this is what's of interest for me right now, like exploring, but not yet, I would say, can materialize anytime soon.
Things are happening fast. You'll be surprised.
Yeah,
you'll be surprised how things are developing, specifically in insurance. We were talking recently in previous sessions, specifically about insurance and how AI and technology is really impacting how decisions are being made, how funds are being spent, how operations is going on. So you'll be surprised how fast these things will materialize and manifest. So it's, yes, very interesting for sure. And yes, the Capstone project, having that impact so near, you know, 5 to 6 years, whatever that bracket is. I mean, some people could see it as threatening or more dehumanizing. Dehumanizing in an industry that, again, I'm sorry, there is a negative, you know, dogma around insurance always that, you know, like you said, you need decisions, you need to go to inpatient now. Sorry, we got to wait for approvals to come in. It's that aspect of commercial versus humanitarian that always has people thinking.
Yeah, but actually, I think it's going more into the preemptive I mean, yes. Not just waiting for the thing to happen or for someone to get sick so we can. No, I think it's, I know that it's now moving towards avoidance and try to preempt certain diseases that may occur using AI and big data, trying to predict
behavior,
for instance, behaviors, nudging certain behaviors to avoid certain diseases that could happen to a certain age bracket and so on and so forth. So this is, I think, now what's, it's more moving towards that side. Investment is actually being done on that side, because eventually it's, let's keep it in simple words, it's going to be a win-win situations. You will be healthier, you will not be experiencing any a medical issue, and on the insurance side, they won't be paying.
Cost saving, yes.
Exactly. So you know, this, you call it like circular economy one way or another.
Yes.
In simple words, yeah.
In layman terms, I always look at this, again, you know, not to underestimate or undervalue the, of course, but I always, not just insurance, even in the medical industry, because of its real humanitarian impact on people, it's such a, I wouldn't say conflict of interest, but just it's such a sensitive issue to have it commercialized. You know what I mean?
It's such a fine line.
So fine. So fine.
That's why you need to have regulators. That's why you need to have, I think regulators are big time important to avoid certain conflict of interest that may occur.
You do need the regulators to come in and sort of balance between people and profits.
And keep it transparent. Yani, why am I working? And eventually, I need to. I need to. I need to profit eventually. Let's be.
It is what it is.
So, if you make it more transparent, then trust will
exactly
will build up. And fine.
And any negative,
pay you and you give me that, even if it's something that's sensitive. Why is it a taboo not to talk about it? Yani? But again, I think it just you need to work more on transparency, this is what many insurance companies worldwide are working on.
Okay, I was going to ask you actually, do you think there is more transparency nowadays?
This is what they are working on. I think, again, social media is making everything now.
It's all connected,
connected, and any such similar situation, you would be aware of it, and you can build your own perceptions on it. If you are unable to manage this properly, you will face an issue eventually if you are unable to adapt with this. So yeah.
I heard something interesting the other day. I don't know if this is just hearsay or not, but apparently everybody's car insurance and stuff like that has gone up simply because there's so many more people in the UAE now. And I was just curious, on the medical insurance side, are you guys seeing this, that we've got more people coming into the UAE? Because this economy seems to be booming despite the fact that the rest of the world is struggling.
Actually, this is why this country is making it mandatory. I mean, if it's part of it that if you want to live in this country, you have to have insurance, not optional, same as the car insurance. But the relativity of price, it's different. There are two things in insurance, in medical insurance specific, that you cannot actually control: the global inflation and the development in the medical industry, in the device,
in the service itself. How's it going to cost?
You have to update your machines, the MRI machine and the CT scan machine and so on. you have to get the latest model, so you have to pay more for it. Mm-hmm. So eventually it goes back to the insurance premium. Mm. And as you grow older, you get a little bit exposed to potential more medical issues. So that's why the cost gets higher. But what I would say, if you're able to control these inflations or these price increases on a country level,
okay,
I think that's where the uniqueness would come in.
So when you started your EMBA, you know, did you envision that so quickly after graduation, you would not only change from broker to insurer, but you would also be changing countries? You know, you 2 years ago, where did you think you would be now?
No, actually, one of the reasons I joined the MBA is actually to get this exposure that will enable me to change country or change market. I would say this is the more accurate word is change market, whether it's changing to a different country or changing to a different scope in the insurance. So, no, that was definitely
a motivating
one of
factor.
The reasons why I joined. And it helped me big time. And I must say, even the career services, they supported in actually how to approach this market and how to maneuver,
take advantage of opportunities.
Not just take advantage, how to
surf,
to stand out,
distinguish.
So
to stand out among anyone else. To
so what advice would you give to somebody who wants to stand out or change markets or you know, change from one player to another within the industry that they're in? Somebody who
I think any change, the change when it says change in career, you either change an industry, you maintain the same function in the same country, or you change the country, or you change the function. So I think it will go same with all of them. People, your network. Talk as much as you can to as many people as you can. Get advices, get help, ask for help. Okay, fine, you can apply online, sure. Maybe you will be selected or maybe it will help you or not. But what will truly help you is talking to people. And these are the ones who are in the market. These are the ones who are, who would choose or pick those who will stand out. So ask him, what are the correct characteristics that I must have to stand out in this function or in this industry or in this market?
It's like putting yourself out there. You know what I mean? Again, out of your comfort zone, putting yourself out there. Yeah. I remember something we spoke about even in a while with, you know, the assignments and with the, you know, deliverables. There was always that, you know, rubric or these key points that you need to checklist. So it's always a, you can spend a lot of time and effort, you know, articulating back and forth and trying to, you know, put your point across, where you can in a very optimum way just check what is required, you know, and just optimize your time, optimize your optimize your time, optimize your effort, and just do what needs to be done.
Hit the mark from the onset.
Hit the targets.
Avoid the assumptions, I would say. Don't avoid the waffle. You have an MBA, then you will have an executive MBA, then you will be an executive the very next step. No, it doesn't. It's not a magic wand. I mean, again, ask.
Yes.
Try not to minimize your assumption and ask what is the reality. What do I need to do do I need to study another thing? Mm-hmm. Do I need to speak with these people? Do I need to articulate these specific skills that I have to get this job, and so on and so forth, to make this change, to open up my own company in this field. And so I think it's all about people. Talk to me. We talked, if you do recall.
Yes.
Yes. My cohorts, the career services, my colleagues. And I mean, I was able, if you allow me to say it, if a friend of mine that we used to work together 10 years back is the one who helped me out to me to get here and work in the company that I work in right now. We haven't spoken in years, but when we connected, because she was the right person to connect with, it was a must that I need to connect with this person, plus 100 more. But this one specific person is the one that helped me out to make this specific move.
So that connection was life-changing. And how did it feel then coming to, I mean, I know you have your friends over here, so you had a support system waiting for you. But your family didn't necessarily have that. So was it difficult for everybody to adjust? Was it easier for you? And, you know, having a really young child, because you said your daughter is 9 months old, so she would have been about four months when you came over. How was that?
And I spent the next 5 months, I haven't seen her except twice in that period. So, yeah, again, it's the beginning of something, so it's not easy. No, it's still in the difficult phase to make this change, to adapt. No, it's not that easy. But again, you look at it, why am I here in essence? And when you recall and live the reason, it starts to make sense. Yeah.
Eyes on the prize. Eyes on the prize.
Yeah. But yeah, it's still difficult. But again, it's the beginning.
Yes.
And everything in the beginning is not as easy as it may look.
Yeah, that's what you said. It's never easy.
Although it's a very easy country to live in.
Yeah.
You'll be surprised how these experiences and challenges that you face really really impact you and change you. So I'm sure Ahmed, who you know applied and got into this program 2 years ago or 2+ years ago, is a completely different person now with all the experiences, the knowledge, the program, the studies. Different person.
My colleagues said it on my behalf.
Who are you?
They know, if you do recall, for the growth mindset.
Yes. Yes, correct.
Alhamdulillah. They tell.
Ahmed was nominated and awarded the most growth mindset, by his peers at Hult.
By his peers, yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, of course. It changed a lot, big time. And I would say the impact is in how to approach things, the how to approach problems, either it's in the job or personal. And if you're able to overcome your challenges on your personal life, trust me, it will automatically show
spill over on the
on your work life big time. So sometimes you think the MBA is good for one thing, but eventually it is helping you in many different areas. Acknowledge that it's helping you in these areas and try to live by these learnings and so on. Yeah.
You get out what you put in. You know, I think the more you give of yourself while you're going through this, I think the more you're going to get out. I know a lot of people when they start, you know, one of the thoughts is, oh my goodness, it's 2 years. How much time do I have to devote to something? But the 2 years will come and go.
Yes.
And at least at the end of 2 years.
We're almost you 1 year.
Yeah, after you we're done. For the almost future.
A year. Alumni. Yeah,
almost done with the let's say with the future mindset that
yeah. just that.
That we.
You're right. If you have a couple of years will fly by, yeah. and yes, and here it is. You know, the clock keeps ticking. It does not stop.
Yeah, it becomes, I think it becomes a lot faster later on. You become more capable, too capable to do even more things, more complex things. And you start to achieve things and you're not conscious about them. You're too stressed, yeah. You're too burnt out, yeah. But when you look back, you don't overwhelm yourself and don't be harsh on yourself. No, we did great and... what's coming, let's tackle it, and so on and so forth, and keep going. Yeah, this is I think this is one of the major, again, change in mindset and perspective I got from the program, is one assignment at a time and one course at the time, one project, and so on and so forth. And خلاص, it keeps rolling over, and the 2 years has passed, and then you come with the more challenges later on that you're able to overcome and keep going. Yeah.
It's that step by step. I mean, marathons, it's just every step, just you're closer to your target every step. So yes, I completely agree and feel the same way. Yes. Do you miss being in a classroom?
Except everyone's talk about these chairs, these are the most things I miss, the chairs, of course.
Can we just have a little bit of lumbar support and an armrest? Yeah. Just say. Yeah.
Of course. Again, the discussions that everyone used to have, the insights. You know, the aha effect, this aha moment is what I really miss. The notes, I always come back to these notes. And
did you ever have like periods where you felt that maybe you couldn't deal with the stress, or that the anxiety might just be a little bit too overwhelming? Or were you just always able to take it in stride? Because I know that some people are struggling with anxiety in respect of the program at various levels.
You're in this program for yourself. And it's for your own benefit. If this is going to stretch you, and this is what it takes to stretch you, go for it. Pass it. You're in the middle of it.
Move forward. Keep pushing for it.
Yeah. Keep pushing for it until it passes. But I would say you're in this situation. You're feeling an anxiety and you're feeling too much stress. Trust me, it's not going to last for long. And trust me, you will wish at some point in time that you would love to get through this stretch once again. Benefit from it as much as you can. I think because what you will face in your job and in your life, in real life, I think it would be even more stressful and more anxiety. So leave it for the real, not in the class, yes. more or in the small meeting room, glass meeting room. No, just leave it for the real life thing and learn how to cope with it here. Again, it's a safe I call it a safe space.
Yes.
Benefit from it and then try to apply it in real life.
I think one of the best pieces of advice that I got was from another podcast, and for the life of me I can't remember which one it is. It was something that I saw on YouTube. And they said that, you know, anxiety can sometimes cloud the mind. So they said, you know, for the overthinkers and for the people that get really anxious, because they're thinking from A to Z, which is great if you can break things down. But sometimes you get so focused on the Z that you forget about your very next step.
Yes.
And if you focus on just that very next step, what do I have to do now? what is one thing that I can do now to make it easier for myself? And you focus on that next step and you take that one. And then what is the next thing that you have to do? And then you make that decision and you go. And it's sort of still built into this whole incremental mindset that we have, because I think everybody always wants to go from 0 to 100. And sometimes when you end up in a group of amazing performers, and maybe if you end up being in a cohort where it seems that everybody is just so adept at adapting, that they do so well, maybe some people struggled more than what they felt that they could, that they could actually discuss or let on. Or maybe they just looked at how you guys were doing it and was like, just my next step.
Yes.
One step at a time, and there we go.
I think this, I'll pinpoint on two things you said, and here is one step at a time, or breaking it down. Sometimes one of these tasks looks very overwhelming. Like, how am I going to do that? Isolate this issue aside, even if it will still be causing you an anxiety, but just park it. And as you mentioned, try to work on the smaller, easier task, achieve them, and celebrate the achievement. And then move on to the bigger task. And once you finish it, celebrate this achievement. Not even celebrate, yani,
acknowledge.
Acknowledge that you did that and you finished that. The second thing is, and I think it was a challenge in the beginning, sometimes you have in your cohort very impressive, well-recognized...
superstars.
Yeah. Well, actually, you're in there for your own benefit, and they're there for their own benefit. If you're unable to keep up, it's fine. Learn to keep up. This is why you are here, to stretch and grow. So, and if they are unable to let their team members or their colleagues keep up with them, then I think they need to learn how to take the rest of the team and lift them up and build them up to the standards. So I think it's not just... the challenge for you to keep up with them, and is also the challenge for the superstars to make other stars out of their team members or their
maybe
cohorts.
To give others room.
Yes.
To give others room.
That's such an interesting perspective, that sometimes giving the room and making other superstars is success.
And that's also part of being a leader.
Yes.
Right?
Yeah, absolutely.
That's exactly thing what it's what it's about, is actually influence and inspire these team members or colleagues of yours to build up and and keep up. So it's a both way thing. Well, again, you're in the program to develop. And you, no one is making you do that.
Exactly. You know, if it doesn't challenge you, it's not going to change you.
And yes, and you're in this program, you're giving it your time, money, and effort, and taking away time from your family and your job and your friends, and you're giving this a lot of things. So... make use of it.
Yes.
And even if you feel that you are not good enough, it's not supposed to make you feel that way. Express it. Even if you're facing this kind of I don't want to call it disability, but unable
challenge
exactly. Challenge to live up to the standards.
Yeah. Express it, be aware of it, and treat accordingly. You know, like you said, break it down, see how you can
address it more than address it.
You know, the one interesting thing that you said was about you know, celebrate the small wins, the small things that you that are easier, that you can do well, and then when you tackle the tougher things and you overcome it. And I mean, you know, because Somebody today, I think, was saying sometimes done is better than perfect. And I do believe that. But the other thing that I have learned is that those things that we find extremely difficult and often that we dislike, because there's this whole, dogma about, you know, we have to motivate ourselves. And the thing is, motivation in life is what gets you started, but motivation doesn't see you through. Someone can be a highly motivated individual, but if you don't have some sort of discipline, you're not going to achieve as much as you would like, no matter how motivated you are to do so. So that's one. And the other thing is, when it comes, it's easy to be motivated about something that you like doing or something that maybe you are very good at doing. It's not everybody that gets motivated or can maintain that level of motivation when things get tough. And there is this one area in the brain, which is just a little bit of neuroscience. It's called the anterior mid-cingulate cortex. And this part of the brain, they've actually done mapping where they show that when you do things that you don't necessarily like or enjoy, but you manage to overcome it, this area of your brain grows bigger. And that is actually where tenacity comes from and determination. Wow. And they're making, you know, they're making assumptions that this is sort of like tied down to the will to live and thrive. So do the things that you do well, do them well, but don't shy away from the things that you think you don't do well at, or even the things that you don't enjoy but are necessary, because those are the things that will make you grow.
Absolutely.
How do you identify that?
The anterior. Oh, another.
Those that you're not sure you're going to do well or you find challenges, I'll tell you. Mm. When you procrastinate them.
Yeah. But the prone procrastination. Okay. Very good.
When you're procrastinating something, this means.
Yes. You have
and
some.
And I have an additional.
You don't
have to seek help.
Yeah.
Seek help. It's quite normal. I even call my wife. I mean, I have, it's very, very simple thing, but I cannot sit down and do it. I need help. What do I do? And then sometimes a little push, you start with this, start with that, do this. It doesn't really have to be discipline so that you can punish yourself if you're unable to do it.
Yeah.
I would say if you are procrastinating something, just seek help. Ask someone to do it with you. Ask someone to help you out. Ask someone to, how do I do it differently so I can enjoy it? Whatever
advice,
it is,
man.
But to be honest.
Or so that I can get through it.
Yes.
You know, because maybe if somebody even helps you, maybe you still won't necessarily enjoy it, but you might enjoy the feeling of having overcome it.
Absolutely. It's just what you just said. Sometimes done is better than perfection.
Yeah.
So you get it done and it opens up a part of your mind to do something else. And just you keep moving, like I said, A to B, B to C, C to D, and all that.
One step at a time.
But what was it called, that part again in the brain?
Anterior mid-cingulate cortex.
I'd love to,
word of the day.
I'd love to have it. I'd love to have an MRI to get this.
I'm good for cortex.
We're gonna need
the cortex part is
insurance approval to get the MRI done.
For the cortex part.
For the cortex. Yeah. But listen, Ahmed, thank you so much for coming on the show today. It's been really wonderful to get to know you a little bit better.
Yes, absolutely. I mean, your insights, very calm and collected, definitely interesting and eye-opening.
Thank you. And I hope I could be of help for my future post-graduate colleagues.
Inshallah.
Big time. Inshallah.
Yeah.
Inshallah.
Thank you so much.
I think there are many that can learn from what you shared today.
Thank you, my man.
All right.
Have a great night.
Thank you.
Cheers.